It was very traumatic when we were sitting in that doctor's office in February of 2010, and he said, we need to consider you for a transplant. I'm sitting there with my wife. She's pregnant. We've got a 3.5-year-old at home. That was very, very tough. And it was hard on my wife, too. You know, she's staring at the face having two small children to have to raise on her own. So, yeah, it's an amazing feeling knowing that I'm going to be there for them. You know, and every day that goes by, I thank God for it, because it's, you know, I've got bonus days now. I really view it that way, you know, that I'm living on, you know, before I was living on borrowed time, now I'm living on a gift, you know, and it's something about the donor, you know, it's someone I don't know and never met, never will meet, but they're a part of me and always will be for the rest of my life. It was an amazing process. You know, I got the call at 5 o'clock on a Sunday afternoon. You know, and it was, I picked up the phone. Of course, I recognized the number as being from Mayo. And, oh, what do they want this time? Wait a second. It's Sunday. Why are they calling me on a Sunday? I start shaking. And, you know, and it was, there was still, you know, I remember calling my wife, telling her to come home. They had a heart for me. Then I called my mother-in-law because they were going to be taking care of our children. And, you know, I could barely talk. You know, my voice was cracking. And, you know, it was a lot of emotions, you know, excitement, fear, panic, relief. I mean, it was everything, you know, hits you all at once. And before you go down to surgery, they talk a lot about that it may not happen. There's some things that can go wrong. They could get the heart there and there could be a problem, you know, so they let you know a few times, you know, that you're going to go down to surgery, and but it may not happen. You may wake up and not have had, you know, the transplant. And then they go over with me exactly, you know, they make sure you understand what's going on, and they put you under. And I woke up, you know, that afternoon, and I'm intubated, so I've got a tube in my mouth. So I get one of the nurses to get me a pencil and paper, and, you know, I write on there, did I get a transplant? And they said yes, and I went back to sleep for about another 10 hours. So woke up just to ask, and then back to sleep. So the only thing that I've been told about my donor is that he was a significantly younger male. Now, what that means, I don't know. When they match you up for donor, of course, they match you by blood type. But they also match you by size. So, you know, my assumption is it was a, you know, full-grown person, you know, that it wasn't a child or something like that. What happens is you are given a way to send a letter to the donor. And in that letter, you can say anything you want with the exception of identifying information. That letter goes through LifeSource. And then LifeSource looks at it and makes sure, again, that you didn't put any specific information in there. And then they call the donor family and they ask the donor family, would you like to receive this letter? And if they say yes, then they forward the letter on to the donor family. The donor family then has an opportunity to write me a letter if they would like to. If they accept the letter, send one back, and I accept the letter, then LifeSource will ask both of us, do you want personal information? And if we agree, then we can contact each other directly after that. When I found out about this, I was still in the hospital just a few days after transplant. And my first initial reaction was, I'm going to write a letter today, you know, because I was euphoric. You know, I was so unbelievably happy that, you know, this process had finally come to fruition, that, you know, I had a healthy heart, you know, going to be able to stay with my wife and watch my kids grow up. And, you know, and I decided against that. It just didn't feel right. I decided to wait a while until my emotions leveled out a little bit. I wrote the letter probably about 2 months after my transplant. So I wrote it before Christmas, right in the middle of December. I haven't sent it yet. I didn't want to send it before the holidays. You know, this is a family that they lost a loved one, you know, and this is the first Thanksgiving and the first Christmas, you know, that they're spending without this person. And I'll send it when it feels right, you know, when I feel, you know, that it's the appropriate time. And I don't know when that's going to be. It could be next week. It could be 6 months from now. You know, just when it feels right, you know, when my gut tells me now's the appropriate time to do it, I'll send the letter to them. And I really hope they respond back. I do. You know, I was diagnosed with my heart condition when I was 12. You know, so this is something I've been dealing with for 28 years now. You know, and I wanted to let them know the journey I had gone through. I also wanted to focus on how grateful I was and how sorry I was for their life, or for the fact that their loved one lost their life. That's one of the most difficult things about this, is to realize, you know, in order for me to live, someone else has to pass away. And because of a decision that they or their family made, I get to live. You know, and that's an amazing thing. That it's a gift that you give to a stranger that you may never meet. And that's just, it's amazing to me. It's an amazing gift. A single donor can help up to 50 people. You know, between live organ donation, corneas, skin grafts, you know, you can help a burn victim, you know, lead a normal life. You can donate your heart, your lungs, kidney, liver. There's just so many different things that a donor can donate and help so many different people. One of the most important things that I think is, if you decide to become a donor, is to express that to your family. Let them know. Because even if you check it off on your driver's license, even if you go to donatelife.net and register yourself, it's still up to your family. And that's the other important thing. You look at Europe, they have an opt-out donor system. Everyone, when they're born, is automatically a donor. And if, because of personal choice or religious reasons or whatever reason, you don't want to be a donor, then you go in and you opt out. Here, you have to opt in. You have to, you know, get approval, or you have to check off on your driver's license, or if you're a child, you have to get your parents to make that decision after the donor has passed away. And it's such a terrible time to bring that up, because they're in such a highly emotional state. You know, it's so difficult. But the wait times in Europe are a fraction of what they are here. And the technology is available, and lives can be saved. You know, so that's the biggest thing that I can say is, become a donor. Talk to your friends and family about becoming donors. It's very important. There are over 100,000 people currently waiting on transplant lists, waiting for live organs right now.